Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the fifth meeting in 2015 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I remind everyone, switch mobile phones off as they affect the broadcasting system. Agenda item one is about taking a decision on business in private. Do we agree to take agenda item two in private? This is an item of correspondence sent to the presiding officer from Jim Murphy, MP. Are we agreed?
No, I'd like to say, could we take it in public? I don't see why it should be in private. Could you perhaps comment on that?
Well, I will explain that I thought at this meeting we might discuss it in private. And if we wish to, I'm in your hands, I'm not... nobody wishes. I'm quite happy to take it in public if you wish. Right? Well, that's fine.
I would like to.
No.
Because I don't see that it should be in private.
That's absolutely okay.
Okay, fine.
We'll take it in public in that case. And let's not worry about that. Right. Okay, that's agenda item one dealt with. And agenda item two is to consider correspondence received by the presiding officer from Jim Murphy, MSP. Now, MP, I beg your pardon, you're perfectly correct, MP. There is also the letter that the presiding officer has sent back to Jim Murphy, in which she says in the last paragraph that I'm passing the letter to the committee for us to consider. Does anyone wish to comment? Yes, David.
Thank you, convener. As everyone here knows, we've got a very good system here, a very tight system that deals with the sort of issues that have been raised here by Jim Murphy. I presume it's on the back of members of Parliament who have been found to be possibly doing things they shouldn't have been doing, and you know, Mr. Murphy wants us to tighten up, but of course we're already looking at that in other ways in the committee. That's been ongoing now for some time. We could obviously take his comments into account, but I think I would be slightly concerned if people thought that we were reacting to this and that there were things going on here that have been happening elsewhere, because we really do have a system here that is very open and very transparent. And you know, I'm pretty confident in the current system, to be honest, and also given what's going through in terms of lobbying and all the rest of it, we're tightening up, and we've got a history of looking regularly at ourselves, at our systems, and improving things as we go along.
Patricia?
Yes. Convener, I think the very interesting thing about Dave's comments, if I may say so, is that when we discussed the introduction of a code of conduct and a register for lobbyists, one of the reasons we were minded to do so was because we recognised that there had been no incidents in this Parliament that we were aware of, but we wanted to make sure that we were doing everything in our power so that, and I think it was referred to in our discussions, albeit in private, that while it had never happened, we wanted to make sure that we had a mechanism in place that prevented it where possible, and if it happened, that we had something that would allow us to react, and we wouldn't be reacting to change the system just because an incident had happened. I think actually what Jim Murphy is suggesting here is very, very similar to that. He is asking that we look at the issue of paid directors and consultants. I would accept what my colleague Dave said about the fact that we're not aware of there having been any incidents in the Parliament, but once again, I think we should err on the side of caution, and we should seriously consider how we would give power to this particular proposal.
Margaret?
Yes, I agree with what's been said already, and Jim Murphy does mention in his letter that he is proud of the Scottish Parliament, which is above reproach. But, you know, he is asking us if we will consider looking at the rules again, because, I mean, Patricia Marwick, the presiding officer, in her response, she does say that there are a very limited number of MSPs that hold a second paid role. And, you know, although that's not consultancy work, there are some who have directorships, and that is permissible. But I think, as Patricia said, when we were looking at the lobbying inquiry, we took the stance that we were looking at it and considering it before, you know, not because something had happened, but because we thought it was a good thing to do, so that we have that rule in place if anything should happen. So I think we should be looking at these rules again and, you know, seriously considering what we do with around MSPs who have second paid directorships or consultancies.
Cameron?
I think part of the issue is that in the House of Commons there are many, many more backbenchers than there are here. Therefore, people don't always have time for it. And there's 600 members of in the Commons and 128 of us, 129 of us here. So I don't really think that issue is coming up. Also, we're discussing so much in lobbying, in the lobbying department, that I don't think we need really worry too much about this at the moment.
Let me just express my personal views and then I'll say something as convener. I think it's always proper that we are challenged as to whether our rules are correct, and Mr. Murphy is properly asking us to look at something in relation to what may have happened elsewhere. And I use the word may because at this stage there are processes to be undertaken elsewhere, perhaps, in relation to what has been in the public domain. We clearly will have an opportunity as a committee. Before I move on to convener's comments, the thing I am specifically uncomfortable about is that instead of focusing on what people do, the letter is focusing on what people are. In other words, that they're consultants or the directors. I'm not interested in the label on people, I'm interested in what people do. And why we should discriminate against one category of employment rather than all, I'm unclear. But I think, now speaking as convener, we will have an opportunity to consider this when we look at our members' interest bill, because that, I think, would be the proper place to do that. And perhaps if members are content, I would propose that we respond. We have been written to by the presiding officer, so it would be proper for us to reply to the presiding officer and copy Mr. Murphy in, so that he's aware of what we're saying to. And I think the response I would recommend to my colleagues is that we do note what's said and agree that we will consider this during our further consideration of the members' interest bill that we plan. I'm seeing you nod, Dave.
Thank you, convener. I'm quite happy with that course of action. I think it's rather unfortunate that Mr. Murphy has already made his mind up. As he says in his letter, he is committing in their manifesto for 2016 that this will happen. It may be necessary for us to do this, but personally, I always like to have a very good look at the facts, the issues, all the consequences before I make my mind up about things like this. At the end of the day, it may well be that when we do look at it through members' interests, that we think that this is something worth pursuing. But it's going to be a commitment in the Labour manifesto, so the mind is made up, which I think is a shame. I think it would have been better if he'd come to us with a more open approach, asking us to look and come back, because there's plenty of time for parties to sort out manifestos before the 2016 election.
Well, I'm not going to succumb to the temptation to engage in a matter of politics. That will be dealt with in the proper place here. I hope that we look at things objectively. There also, of course, is the opportunity as the lobbying bill goes forward to look at that facet of it, and that may be a proper place for it to be dealt with. But I think in our work programme we have a number of opportunities to deal with this, and I think it would be the proper thing at this stage to write to the presiding officer and copy Jim Murphy. Yes, Gil.
I need to declare an interest, convener, because I own a family business that I can't shut down just because I'm here. There is an income from time to time. I may say to you this year, it's not been a good, or last year wasn't a good year, no income at all. It fluctuates, but there's nothing I can do about that. It's like a farmer closing his farm. You know, I've got over just under 50 people now working for me. So, I mean, I'm here, and if I shut it down, what happens to them? So, but the one thing I would say to you, I have declared in my members' interest 20 days a year. I've never spent, in the whole time I've been in Parliament, I've never spent a day in my business, one single day. I've spent the odd hour in business. So, actually, in terms of this Parliament, looking at, I take the same view as we've taken when it comes to looking at people that engage with us. I don't think there's anything wrong in belt and braces. I really don't. And I'm encouraged by what you said, that we should look at what we do rather than names that are given. I'm also, up until recently, I have been a board member of Rape Crisis Scotland. In that situation, although I'm a board member, no expenses, no wages, nothing. Cup of tea is all I could declare from there, and sometimes a biscuit. I'm also a board member of an organisation that covers the whole of the United Kingdom. I don't get any expenses, I don't get anything, no remuneration, nothing. I do it because I want to help. So when you see somebody labelled as a board member of something, don't assume that you're making big bucks from it. It's normally the opposite. It's out your pocket when you're in this place.
Okay, I think that's all duly noted. Right, I've proposed that we write to the presiding officer saying we, you know, there are two opportunities going forward. Patricia.
Yeah, you probably didn't see me, convener, but I had been trying to indicate to you I wanted in. It's just to clarify for Gill, Mr. Murphy's letter actually talks about paid directors or consultants, so your voluntary work would, of course, not come into that category and is something that should be cause for congratulations rather than otherwise. But I would also point out to Dave that while Mr. Murphy has indicated that it will be in Labour's manifesto for 2016, that's a matter for the Labour Party. But what he has done in this letter is to write to the presiding officer, as he says, to ask that we consider beginning the process of banning paid consultancy work and directorships by referring the issue to the Standards Committee to consider the appropriate changes to Parliament's code of conduct. It isn't about making this committee making a judgment on the hoof, as it were. It is suggesting to the committee they want to consider it. I actually think it is a separate piece of work from the work that we're already doing. It may have links and it may have read across, but I do honestly think that it is something that we could look at regardless of the other two pieces of work we're doing.
Yeah, just really to follow on, convener, from Gil's point, this is not a simple thing. I mean, what is the definition of paid consultancy work? Directorships might be an easier thing to define, but paid consultancy work, I'm a vice president of the UK Trading Standards Institute. My career was in trading standards. I hosted an event this week, a consumer empowerment event. I'm hosting a young consumer thing in another couple of weeks and so on. And I don't get paid for that post either, just the same point Gil was making. And I've claimed expenses from them once when I went down to the UK annual conference in Brighton. This is a hugely complex issue. Would that be caught as paid consultancy work? You know, this needs a lot of very detailed consideration. It's not an easy and simple thing to deal with, which is the implication, I think, in the letter. We will get down to that detailed discussion, of course, when we consider it. And I'm quite comfortable about your own suggestions that there will be opportunities for us to do that in our work programme.
Anyone else wish to say anything? No, we at the moment, I think, have two views on the subject, that the view has been expressed that this should be a separate piece of work, and there is a view being expressed by the committee that we have two opportunities in, as we take lobbying forward and as we look at the members' interests. Do you wish to press this to a decision, Patricia? Because I think the balance of the committee is against you.
Yes, I realise that, but you know, colleagues are making the point that we need to consider this very seriously, mm-hmm. and I think you best do that by considering it as a piece of work. A piece of work that, yes, has read across to other issues and other matters, but one that could be looked at on its own.
Oh, it certainly could be looked at on its own. I don't think anyone in the committee is saying otherwise than that. I think it's whether it should be. And by the way, if we were to look at it in the context of lobbying and the members' interests and conclude that we had to do work, I don't propose that if we take a decision today that our existing work programme can accommodate this, that rules out our returning to the issue if we find that does not adequately deal with it. That's just procedurally, I think it would be important to say that so that we don't end up saying if we go the road of using our existing work programme that we're barred from looking at it by other means if we conclude we need to come back to that subject. I made the proposal we use our existing work programme. Do we wish to divide the committee?
I mean, we've heard from different members around the table that, you know, it is a serious consideration that we've got to make on this, and perhaps it does require to be looked at separately. Mm. And I mean, I don't know how our programme is that we could actually fit it in this term.
Well, currently we will be looking at the rules on lobbying in May, and what I'm suggesting is that we can consider it at that time.
Can I suggest, convener, that we come back to our next meeting with a short report from the clerks indicating, you know, the work programme and the opportunities for fitting this in rather than make a decision?
Well, let's put it
now.
This way. We're looking at the rules for lobbying in May anyway. That's already something we've agreed as a committee. I'm content we could do that, but I suggest that it would be unlikely that the clerks would say we could do it any earlier. Let me put it no stronger than that, but given that May is 6 or 7 weeks away.
Rather than make a decision just now and divide the committee, that we could come back and have a look with a bit more information about the work programme and how this would fit into it, because if it fits into it neatly, then, you know, that would lead us to take it as part of another bit of work. If it looked as if it wasn't going to fit in neatly, then, you know, the points being made about it as a separate part of work might gain more momentum. It would be useful maybe just to get a short note from the clerks at the next meeting, just where we can decide either way.
Well, are others going to fall in behind David's suggestion? It's kind of my question. Patricia? A note from the clerks at the next meeting?
I mean, my concern about having it as a piece of work that is part of the other work we're doing is that we're actually quite far along with the work on those two issues. This is fairly fundamental in the sense that it's we were at pains with the lobbying inquiry to make it clear we weren't talking about MSPs, we were talking about lobbyists. Yep. This is about MSPs. And my concern would just be if it was rolled up into other work that we would be so far along that it would be much more difficult to make it cohesive and make it work. Whether it's worth having the clerks do a job of looking at where it could fit in, I'm not sure, because if there's a willingness to have it fit in, then it'll fit in, is my view. So, you know, I'm not sure what's to be gained from that.
My preference would be simply to decide today that we incorporate it in our existing work programme, where we've two elements of work, two opportunities. Right. Does the committee want to divide? Because I think the committee is clearly of that view that we fit it in. But that we do note on the record that if we find that the existing opportunities to look at it do not provide it, that is not blocking off that we can return to the issue at a later date and schedule a specific piece of work. You know, to make that absolutely clear. Are we content to proceed on that basis today?
As long as we're committed to taking this piece of work forward.
That I am committed to doing, and I get the impression. You know, the point has properly been made to us, and I think we'll proceed on that basis. Right, I'm very grateful for that. That's helpful. And that completes agenda item 2. We now move into private session.